Micro for inviting me for this talk. So I'm going to talk about human elephant conflict and elephant conservation in Sri Lanka. Unfortunately, Sri Lanka has the unenviable position of having the highest level of human elephant conflict in the world. This picture says it all. An elephant came to China and he got shot dead right at the chain. Elephants suffer in many ways from the conflict. This way, this length is cut to the wall, cross there. It's going to get tangled and die. This baby has bitten on what's called hakkapatas or jawbone, and all his mouth is destroyed. He can't eat or drink, so he's going to starve and die. These two females and their young ones fell into irrigation well, and they've been swimming the whole night. This baby fell into a abandoned pit and died. A farmer connected main street city to a barbed wire fence, and four elephants died that day. Elephants are shot. And in this manner, in Sri Lanka, we killed about 250 elephants every year. Last year, it exceeded 300. There are only 13 countries with Asian elephants in the world. Many of those countries don't even have 250 elephants. The other side of the story, elephants break crops, especially paddy. And they can destroy an entire field in one night. And once the farmers collect the paddy, harvest it, store it at the house, the elephants break the houses to get at the stored paddy. And in this process, sometimes they injure and they kill people. In Sri Lanka, in this manner, about 70 people die every year. Now, elephant management has a long history. The original initial plans were developed in the 1940s based on the knowledge that was available then. And we have been following this plan to date. Although there's a lot more information now available, and that information tells us that this plan is entirely wrong. So let me talk a little bit about that. So this plan called for elephants to be restricted to a number of protected areas, which were to be linked by corridors. Currently, what we have as protected areas under the Department of Wildlife Conservation, where the elephants are supposed to be, are these colored areas. The corridors have got lost in the ensuing years. And we use a number of methods to try and limit elephants to these protected areas. And they are translocation, elephant drives, electric fences. And in spite of having tried to limit elephants to protected areas in this way for more than 70 years, we have a lot of conflict ongoing today. And another measure that we have adopted is to distribute huge firecrackers to farmers, which are called elephant thunders. So today, considering the title of the session is Harmonizing Knowledge with Applications, I will talk a little bit about the use of technology to find solutions to this problem. So I will speak briefly about four different instances of first, let's look at translocation. And once you put one of these colors, we program it to take a GPS position every 4 hours, so we know where exactly the elephant is every 4 hours. So we've been translocating elephants from about 25 years, and then we decided, now that we have this technology, let's use a collar to find out what happens. Translocations are usually done when an elephant repeatedly kills people or comes into a village and repeatedly breaks houses or a lot of public protests, and then the department will go and catch that elephant, put him in a truck, take him to a faraway national park and release him. So this is a single tusk elephant, an adult male, that was in the northwest of the country. We call him Chandi. He was a problem maker. He was captured and one of these collars were put on him. And he was transported by truck from a place called Kodigahawewa in the northwest to Somavati National Park in the middle of the country. So Somavati is an excellent place for a young bull elephant like this. There's a lot of water, there's lots of grass, there's lots of large herds of elephants, these beautiful female elephants. So everything that a adult male wants should be there. What did Chandi do? Immediately left the park, went up to Kamtale, crossed Habarana, went down to Galevela, and walked back to Hakwana. The direct distance between where he was captured and released was 100 kilometers. He walked 243 kilometers over 28 days to come back home. Another elephant we call him Brigadier. You can see he's almost obese because he's a mature breeder. Every day he goes and trades ferry. He was captured again in the northwest in a place called Telhara, transported across country and released in Madhu. Again, a fabulous place for elephants. Again, Brigadier also left the park as soon as it was released. But if he wanted to go back home to Telhara, he had to go directly west. There was something wrong with his direction finding equipment, and instead of going west, he kept going north. After 2 weeks, he came to Sampur, and for the first time in his life, he saw the sea, because he's an elephant that was born and grew up in the middle of the country. What did he do? He jumped into the sea and he swam off. Why, we don't know. Maybe he was trying to seek exile in Australia for all the problems that were causing him. Somehow, the Navy was patrolling the sea and they, in a boat, and they saw this thing floating. They thought it must be a whale and they went to have a look. And then a trunk came out of the water. They were flabbergasted. What's the elephant doing here? 5 kilometers offshore in an area, 300 feet deep, swimming away. They thought maybe there was a flood when he got washed off or something. And in an amazing operation, they sent down 2 divers underwater who noosed his leg, and then the Navy dragged him back to Sri Lanka and then again released him. After that, he didn't try to go back home, but he settled in a Jantipur area close to Southport. But he went back to doing what he knew to do, his usual job of trading and causing conflict. So in Chandi's case, the problem remained the same because he came back. In Brigadier's case, the problem was solved in Telhara, where he was captured. But we started a new problem where there was no such problem, Jantipur. So not only did we translocate the elephant, but we also translocated the problem. So in this manner, we have, and then about 6 months later, Brigadier fell into a well and died. So in this manner, with the wildlife department, we have monitored about 25 elephants. Not a single one of them stayed in the park he was released. All these were adult males. All of them left the park. Some came back, some tried to come back, couldn't find the way, walked over huge areas, caused immense problems. Some settled in a new area, but if they did, they went back to doing what they did. So now we had to accept that translocation of this manner going forward. So then the department came up with what's called elephant holding ground or an elephant prison. Now there's the second one that is now in Borobudur. First one was a area in Tamil. So this is like Jurassic Park. There are huge columns studded with 6-inch nails. There are steel cables and there are electric fences on either side of it. And the elephants are now put in here. 2 elephants that were put in here were monitored. One came back from even this maximum security prison. The other one starved to death inside. And after that, monitoring was stopped because ignorance is bliss. So up to now, about 60 elephants have been put in here. No one really knows what happens to them. Some have escaped, many have starved to death, and the general thinking is that there are maybe 7 or 8 elephants in the island. So you can have knowledge, you can have technology, but they cannot provide solutions unless managers are open to questioning what is being done and changing what they do. So currently there are plans to build an even bigger elephant prison in Julpallama, spending more than ₹1 billion or ₹2 billion. This is the south part of southern part of the country. The green acres are national parks, and Mundala down below. And this area was zoned for development under the UDA as the Greater Harmony Development Area for development needs till 2030. Fortunately, at that time, we had tracking data for elephants, which was given to the people who were doing the zoning, and they took it into account and they recognized an area that was to be declared for as a managed elephant range, that the elephants will remain there. And they changed their plans and incorporated that into the zoning plan. This was done by the CEA and the UDA in 2009. But still, it has not proceeded beyond that. Some years later, about 5 years later, the wildlife department took it up, and by that time, about 1/3 of this area had been encroached. So all those areas were left aside, and the remaining area was to be declared as the managed elephant range. But many years have passed since then, and still nothing has been done. Now the area is actually split into two due to these encroachments. So this was the UDA and the CEA did this in order to minimize the human-elephant conflict that could arise in this area through development. But it has got stuck. So similarly, you can have knowledge, but you cannot solve problems if those in authority prevent it for whatever reasons. The third thing I'm going to talk about is electric fences. Elephants great crops, that's why we have conflict. Of course, we were cultivating areas with elephants and then they get crops more. Anyhow, electric fences are probably one of the very few things that are successful in preventing elephants from raiding crops. Today, the Wildlife Department has constructed more than 4,300 kilometers of electric fencing in Sri Lanka to mitigate human elephant conflict. The perimeter of Sri Lanka is only about 1,500 kilometers. So you can wrap Sri Lanka around 3 times with electric fencing. The amount of electric fencing we are putting. But still, we have such a lot of conflict. So doesn't the fences also work? The problem is this. We have fences. On one side we have forest, which belongs to the wildlife department. On the other side, we have forest, which belongs to the forest department. So like the Berlin Wall creating East Germany and West Germany, we have electric fences which have created wildlife department elephants and forest elephants. There are elephants on both sides of these fences. This is an area of the northwest. The red lines depict the electric fences in this area where the elephants are supposed to be. This is some tracking data of the elephants. Has absolutely no bearing to where the fences are. Not that there are no elephants in the other areas, there are elephants. These are the only elephants that we have tracked in that area. Kodigahawewa National Park. These two are two female herds. This is another female herd that is outside the electric fences in the forest department area. The electric fences are preventing them from going into the park. So there are villages here, there are villages here. There are no electric fences between these forest department elephants and the villages. In elephants, they have a very distinct social structure. Females and young are in groups. The males are single. Most of the problems are due to males. This is a male in the same area. The electric fence has no relevance to him. He goes through the fence wherever he wants. So differences against the males, it has no impact on them. It has a huge impact on the female birds. If you put up a fence inside the forest between wildlife and forest department areas, if there are elephants here in the forest department area, and if they were only using these resources, now they cannot use those resources anymore. They have to either starve to death here, break the fence and go here, or they will go into new areas, developed areas, in search of resources. So these fences actually increase conflict. These fences are made with public money, for which you and I pay. It costs about 600,000 rupees per kilometer to put up a fence. In a year or two, they are dysfunctional. So then you have another project to rehabilitate the fence or put it up again. What is the problem? Why are we putting up these fences? It's to protect people, their property, their lives. So where should the fences be? In some ways, the far away inside the forest, or where the people are. Obviously, if you want to protect something, the fence needs to be where that is. So it has to be on the boundary of where the people are and what they need to protect. So we have taken this approach, and we have piloted village electric fences. So these electric fences are only to protect villagers. The villagers decide where the fence goes, and the planning is done based on what needs to be protected. The villagers are involved in making the fences, and they maintain the fences, and they work very well. Similarly, raiding paddy is a big problem, but every paddy field has a farm. Every tract of paddy has a farm society. So we work with the farmers, and we have piloted very simple electric fence that the farmer society can put up. Similarly, like the village fence, it's on the boundary of the paddy field. The farmers put it up before they cultivate, and then they farm the area, and once they harvest, they roll it up and take it back home. And in many cases, the next day, herds of elephants come into the area and live to eat the Ipananda or the leftover harvest. So that's probably tourism potential here. So the take-home lesson here is knowledge and technology can provide us with tools, but they need to be used in an appropriate manner. If they're used in the wrong manner, they will not provide you with solutions to your problems. Finally, train accidents. Train accidents kill about 5 to 10% of elephants annually. Whether that's a major problem or not is a different discussion. We will not go into that today. But yes, it is a problem. There is a lot of social awareness of this problem. And there have been many attempts to solve this problem through technological means. By fixing thermal cameras, by fixing infrared cameras, all kinds of things, by having signals to direct elephants. So all these are instant solutions. We have been doing these instant solutions. The first one has a date, March 2013. This is 2019. We are still doing instant solutions and haven't found a solution. We live in a world of instant gratification. We have instant noodles, instant coffee, we want everything instant. You can't do everything instant. There are things that you need to spend time and the effort to study, understand the problem, and then only you can come up with a solution. So none of these measures, such as fixing gadgets to trains, will work for the very simple reason that a train, once you apply emergency brakes, takes more than a kilometer to come to a stop. A train will hit an elephant that is jumping just in front of the train. So there is no point in warning the train about an elephant that is on the track when the train is 1 kilometer away. So you cannot, whatever gadget you fix to the train, when an elephant jumps in front of the train, cannot stop the train. So what is the solution? You can go slow. Elephants get hit in the night. What's the problem of a night train going a little bit slow through these areas that there are elephants? We can use radio collaring to find out where elephants cross this track. So this is an area in the north central Aburan area. The black line is the railway line. It goes completely through the middle of elephant habitat. All these dots are linkage positions of elephant herds. So elephants, it goes through a very densely used elephant area, and frequently elephants get knocked down here. So there are simple solutions. Solutions don't have to be always high-tech. Sometimes a little bit of common sense and studying the problem can provide us with solutions. Unfortunately, as they say, common sense is not very common. Thank you. So I will stop there.
Ladies and gentlemen, we have come to